So I want to welcome the folks who are participating. The workshop title is Military Solutions Are Really the Problem. They Escalate Global Violence, and we should be choosing humane and sustainable ways for a true kind of security, not the military security that's foisted upon us. And there's a short description for what we'll be doing here. And basically, in our daily lives, we know better than to think that violence solves problems. But at the national level, the US government routinely threatens and uses military violence all over the world. Militarism actually makes problems worse. And so why does the government keep using militarism? This is the kind of stuff we'll be exploring here. Who benefits from this? That's maybe a way to help us understand why militarism continues. So our intention in this workshop is to thoroughly debunk the use of military violence as a way to solve international problems. And we could achieve more profound and holistic national security and real security by renouncing violence and promoting peace and fairness nationally and globally. So this highly participatory workshop is one in which I will read a little bit or paraphrase a little bit, ask a question, and the participants will toss out answers. And I'll ask another question, you'll toss out short answers. It's not one that allows us to have a thorough discussion, but if we want to have a thorough discussion later, we could gather at a mealtime, or if something bold were to come out of this, even at the activist fair on the Saturday or Sunday morning time. But this is basically, it's a whole sequence of questions and short answers is what we've got. So I want to start with a quick story. Now suppose I were to say that on the opposite side of my hometown, there's a family that was having difficulties. There was some domestic violence. The kids were afraid of safety. And so I took it upon myself to get some guns and go over and shoot whoever was causing the domestic violence in that family on the other side of town. But I don't quite know exactly who that person is. So I started shooting a number of people in that neighborhood, hoping that I'd somehow happen to hit the right people. And what I did actually was antagonize a number of the neighbors who got shot. I expected that they would treat me as a liberator. I expect them to thank me for coming there and saving them from domestic violence. Instead, I had the whole neighborhood mad at me. So I thought, well, what ingrates? I'm going to go home, buy some more guns, come back and do some more shooting, you know. And my own house in this story has a leaky roof, has plumbing that doesn't work, and my family is not being well fed. And so I used the money that I should have been using on food for my family and housing repairs to go out and buy even more guns. Well, you can see how this kind of thing can escalate. And so when people in my family criticized me for these bad priorities, my response to criticism was to spy on their phone calls and their emails, because I don't want people criticizing me, you know, so I should be spying on their, and that just made my family even more disruptive, more antagonistic to me. I mean, so things feed on themselves. And we know in our daily lives, if somebody were to do that, you know, that's just like way beyond reality. But at the national level, that's what we do in other countries, and it's routine. And although folks here at this gathering would question that, a lot of people in the news media, a lot of people in government just accept that as just fine. So what we'll do in the workshop is I'll read something or say something, and then we'll have some questions, we'll toss out quick answers, and we'll move through. It's quite a sequence of things to move through, but we'll actually make progress and come out at the end in a better place than where we started. So we had the United States had a Department of War from 1789 to 1947, and during that long time, more than a century and a half, our nation fought really very few foreign wars. But in an Orwellian irony, since 1947, when the Department of War changed to the Department of Defense, the U.S. has been almost constantly at war, and we've simply pretended that these wars were for our defense. So it's this great Orwellian twist of language, right? Since the late 1940s, the United States has really felt entitled to bomb and attack a great many countries. We've overthrown governments, we've overthrown functioning democracies, just because U.S. government people or U.S. business people didn't like them. Likewise, the United States has armed and supported a great many dictators and truly violent thugs who have served the interests of U.S. businesses and the U.S. government elites. So we've been fighting wars pretty much nonstop now for about 70 years, but 1942 was the last time that Congress actually declared war. All of our subsequent wars have been started by presidents with or without approval by Congress, in violation of the U.S. Constitution, and often in violation of the War Powers Act, which Congress had passed during the Vietnam era as a way to stifle exactly that kind of thing. And they just do wars anyway in violation. So, first question we have for you. The United States has military bases in almost every country on Earth. I mean, almost every country has U.S. military bases. Does anybody know roughly about how many numbers, how many bases do we have in other countries?
32.
Okay, other numbers that we...
800?
Yeah, I'll say around 800.
Yeah, that's what I had in my notes. There are different ways of calculating how big is a base to get counted, but around 800 is what a number of people have been citing. This is a huge number, and I didn't write down how many countries. It seemed like I'd heard like 150-ish or something like that.
Maybe that's what I heard.
So, yeah, that might be the number of countries. Yeah, I mean, it's really huge. During the Cold War, the United States created NATO, and the USSR created the Warsaw Pact. This is a question for everybody except Mary Hansen, who knows the answer, because she was just on our July TV program with Bernie discussing this very point. Mm-hmm. So after the Cold War ended a quarter of a century ago, the Warsaw Pact that the USSR had started dissolved, but the U.S. continued to dominate NATO, and what did NATO do after the Cold War ended?
Expanded.
All right, okay.
It expanded their mandate about what they were supposed to do.
They placed missiles around Russia's borders.
Yep, so we pushed right up, right up around Russia's borders, and we've done actions that are not in the North Atlantic, but are geographically elsewhere, so a bunch of stuff. Okay, so nearly 200 years ago in 1823, United States President James Monroe proclaimed the Monroe Doctrine, which asserted, with absolutely no basis in international law, he asserted that European nations were prohibited from interfering in any nation in North or South America, and if they did, the United States would react militarily against them. The United States, in effect, asserted dominance over the future of the entire Western Hemisphere. And Latin American governments came and went, but the United States repeatedly intervened militarily in Latin America. We overthrew democracies, we supported military dictatorships, we exploited Latin America economically, and I wonder if we could just toss out the names of some countries in Latin America where the United States has overthrown democracies or supported military dictatorships. Just call out the names of the countries.
Nicaragua.
Guatemala.
Chile.
El Salvador. I know Honduras is one that Kerry cares about.
We
tried to overthrow Cuba. We did the coup in Chile on September 11th of, what year was that? When we overthrew Allende and imposed Pinochet.
73.
Okay. Yeah. So it's pretty much widespread. In recent years, and you can draw in closer if you want, we'd be happy to welcome you in. In recent years, especially after the Soviet Union's collapse, many Latin American nations replaced their military dictatorships with real democracies. The United States did not help that process of democratization. If you bear in mind things that happened that led them to democracies in these different places, the United States did not help those democratization efforts. We did not use the U.S. military to either create their freedom, protect their freedom, support their democracies. The United States military has not been fostering democracy in those countries. But the United States military, as we've said, has actually been overthrowing democracies and installing dictatorships. So Okay, who could briefly summarize in just like a sentence or two the work of the U.S. Army School of the Americas, located in Fort Benning, Georgia? I mean, who could just identify, just so everybody knows, oh yeah, that's that thing. Go ahead.
Well,
yeah, yeah.
What'd she say?
Tortures.
Yeah, it's known as the School of Assassins.
Right. And what they do is what?
Train death squads.
Train death squads.
Well, it's a way of having influence on the leaders, the military leaders of Latin America.
Yeah. So. Yeah, a great number of the people who have committed the worst atrocities turn out that they had been, trained at U.S. School of the Americas. Okay, so there's this pattern. And now the United States has extended the war on drugs into Mexico, Central America, and South America. To what extent is that relevant to the workshop's topic about how military solutions are actually the problem? Well, in what ways, who could say something about the U.S. military's war on drugs in Latin America?
It basically gives them a foothold for developing military strategies, police state tactics, and there's been many critics, some from law enforcement people who are respected in those countries, that are against the war on drugs. And say it doesn't work.
Right. Okay. Other...
The money bribes the leaders or bribes the politicians so that the U.S. government has more control over the administration of that country.
Right. Other insights into this, Carrie?
Guns into the country.
Yeah.
Not dealing with the real issues, the poverty, the corruption,
right.
Lack of democracy.
Yeah, and so what happens then if people rise up and say, hey, we're tired of the corruption, we're tired of the economic exploitation of the poor people, then now those governments have a big military, thanks to funding from the U.S. war on drugs, that the oppressive governments can repress the people using military equipment from the war on drugs and military training from the war on drugs to perpetuate economic injustice. So it keeps that cycle of violence and injustice going. The United States keeps declaring war on lots of things. We have a war on drugs. We had a war on poverty. We have a war on terror. What happens if we frame everything as a war? What does the war mentality do to people?
Insecurity.
Fosters a sense of insecurity. Okay?
Aids the military.
It what?
Aids the military.
It aids the military.
It pulls them together into common cause.
Okay, tell us more about that. What?
Well, it unites in a mindset that heads in the direction of a violent action, of a push, of a control.
Okay, so it pulls us together into an us versus them. And where the us is actually dominated by whoever's in the government that's doing the war on.
Yeah. You know the phrase, military-industrial complex?
Right. Yeah, so it feeds our money into weapons manufacturers and a persistent, perpetual war economy.
It also begins to make the war, the word war seem almost meaningless. Because there's a war on this, a war on
that. Oh,
war
okay. So
war doesn't sound, it becomes a more usual thing in your life than an unusual.
Yeah, so it normalizes endless war.
And I think even more than that, I think the United States is really good at making its own population think that war is good. We take a war on poverty, and then there's a war on terror.
Yeah.
And, you know, and there's this idea, well, you know, war is like a good thing.
Yeah.
Like getting rid of cockroaches or something.
Right.
No, it
is. And that's
integrated into the popular culture.
Exactly. So it's these kinds of things we're talking about that are the sense of the workshop, and these are the answers I was hoping to hear.
War, there's a good guy and there's a bad guy.
Yeah.
And in the United States, we have this mentality between good versus bad.
Yeah.
And that we don't examine.
Right. Okay. I want to move on. I've got actually on my copy of the thing here. I've got a time markers, and where I'm so trying to move us along. This is a fast-paced workshop, and we'll be moving quickly. But some of these things need to get fleshed out. We've done great. So in an international crisis, people say, oh, we have to do something. You know, there's some international crisis out there. Oh, we have to do something. In this country, oh, we have to do something means we have to do something violent, right? That's the assumption. it just funnels that fear, that need, that crisis into something violent. So that assumption's there, and military reactions displace honest diplomacy as a way to handle something. So instead of saying, "Oh, we have a disagreement with this country, let's talk it through and see what we can figure out," diplomacy is denigrated as somehow naive. Did you refer to it as the N-word, or did somebody else I was talking to? We were talking about this. He said that this is the other N-word, is naive. You know, so if you're for peace, we get written off as naive.
I'm saying, so to a preemptive strike, maybe that's the wrong term, is to use, if you're in a discussion with some militaries, use that word to describe their approach to reality. It's naive to think you'll ever achieve peace through violence.
Yeah, yeah.
So that way you defuse, because that's one way they get you, is they call you naive. Idealistic.
Yeah. So the sense of this workshop is to show what Stephen is urging, which is you can turn the tables around and say, we're actually more secure if we create systems where people can get along and get their needs met and collaborate. And the notion that violence solves problems doesn't work. And so it's naive to pretend that after 10,000 years of war, that somehow the next war is actually going to bring peace. You know. Yeah. Anyway, so that's that kind of a thing. A lot of this stuff, as we've said already, is sort of embedded in the culture. It's gotten embedded in the culture. And we get it not only from the government officials, but we get it from other people in Congress. We get it in the mainstream news media. They frame things in that way. You know, I mean, this is how they'll frame, this is how they write the headlines. This is how they write the stories. This is how they decide what to cover on TV or on the radio. Even NPR is basically the same as everybody else. And so that assumption is that to do something means do something violent. And what I would ask us to play with briefly is, why is violence automatically assumed to be the appropriate response? Why are we funneled into that? Why is
because
violence?
War is glorified.
War is glorified.
Money to be made off of war.
Money to be made off of war. Wow.
It's a fascist mindset that we're being sucked into.
Okay. Yeah.
Well, I just watched one of Tom Cruise's movies, and the theme was just like Arnold Schwarzenegger and everybody else, is we have this theme that the good guy has to use violence to solve the problem.
Yeah.
The bad guy, whatever you want to do, whatever the bad guy does, it's justified to do violence against him. And nobody questions
that's
our value.
Right. This is called the myth of redemptive violence. I don't think I used this in my notes, but it's called the myth of redemptive violence. You look at the Western movie, and it ends up with a shootout on Main Street, and the good guy's wearing the white hat, the bad guy's wearing the black hat, and the good guy always wins. Or the spy movie that ends with a chase scene, or the crime movie that ends with a chase scene, and the cars collide and there's an explosion or something blows up and whatever, but the good guys prevail through violence. Mm-hmm. And it's the myth of redemptive violence. I heard Jim Forrest say that at a speaking engagement in Seattle probably about 30 years ago. At that time he was editor of FOR's Fellowship magazine, and he talked about that, and he went on at more length than we have time to do here about how that's so much embedded in our movies and our scripts and our way of thinking and our culture. And so thanks, Carrie, for mentioning that. But the myth of redemptive violence.
Huh? And our vocabulary.
Yeah, yeah, yes, yeah.
I was just going to say, I think that of movies, the alternative to that I think is in some ways the best one from our side is Rebel Without a Cause. Because in Rebel Without a Cause, you see these two guys that are enemies become friends right before a tragedy kills one of them in the Chicken Run.
Uh-huh.
But it's so sad. I mean, it's a system that's gone out of control, and these toys can't stop it. And that's, I think, our feeling of powerlessness when we deal with war is a feeling of powerlessness to stop it. How do you stop it? But the Rebel Without a Cause one was two guys, you know, just two upon.
Yeah. a fun thing to do sometime, not in this workshop, but some other conversation, would be to talk through examples of movies that ended one way but could have ended another way. And I think of the Milagro Beanfield War, which was a wonderful movie until it got to the end, and it ended with a shootout, which was altogether stupid, and I thought a violation of the sense of how the plot was developing. It should have ended up with massive nonviolent resistance of the Latino farmers saving their water supply from the big real estate developers, and instead it ended with a stupid shootout. But anyway, we could play with other. I got to move on.
Yeah.
The U.S. government uses militarism within the United States also, right? So regardless of which party controls Congress or the presidency, U.S. government uses militaristic methods against our own people within our own country. And who can give examples? Just toss them out quickly. We got to move on.
Kent State?
Well, the military equipment going to the local police.
Militarizing local police?
The Occupy movement.
Ferguson.
They use it on the Occupy movement?
Ferguson.
The invasion of the Lakota Reservation at Wounded Knee.
Yeah.
Which took place before the Indians responded.
Right. Right. And war on drugs, we've already talked about. Pardon me?
Disasters
get militarized in a way rather than try to really help the people.
It's
it becomes a control thing. Shock doctrine feeds into that. The prison industrial complex feeds into this because big prison systems is a militarized function.
What about Ruby Ridge and Waco, places like that, where they going?
Oh,
yeah. You get some extremists, and we do that. Yeah, the Attica brothers had valid reasons to protest at that prison in New York State. And so we can see this happens domestically as well. Is it any surprise then that a lot of people within the United States are experiencing the police as an occupying army, and that police very often overreact with far more violence than needed, including shooting unarmed people? So overall, military violence in other countries and also at home has become the default assumption for how to deal with any problem, whether it's foreign or domestic. And if militarism is the default, this displaces looking for more workable solutions. If the only tool is a hammer, you will treat every problem as if it were a nail. So we've been locked in, as we've said several times during this conversation, we sort of get locked into this cultural way that no matter what the problem is, no matter what the crisis is, there's a military way to do it. And it's wimpy to think about diplomacy. Diplomacy is kind of off the table because, after all, we're real Americans.
The thing is, ironically, it appears fast. I mean, it appears fast. It's sort of like, it's painful to be in this conflict. Let's get it over fast.
Yeah.
Let's cut it off. Sure. Let's eliminate it.
Yeah.
So that we can go back to feeling more comfortable.
Right.
And it's, of course,
it does. Yeah. Well, the Iraq war was supposed to take just a couple of weeks.
That's right.
The whole thing was going to be gone in a couple of weeks. That was it.
Shock and awe.
Shock and awe. Yeah.
And cost only how much?
Yeah. Oh, trillions. Yeah.
No. It's a figure of
It's supposed to count.
Oh, it was supposed to pay for itself because we were going to take their oil, use Iraq's oil to pay for our invasion and destruction of Iraq.
So it's
everybody
all based on lies.
Everybody's going to come over to our side
and decide we were
great and set up a government in cooperation.
Okay, so this disparity that we see is something that Martin Luther King was really on top of. He criticized the war in Vietnam on several grounds. He said the United States was on the wrong side of the history. He said that the war was wasting money that should be spent on poverty, on human needs, on making us a better society, on fulfilling the American dream for everybody, not just for the rich. And exactly 1 year before he was assassinated, on April 4, 1967, in his speech that's often referred to as Beyond Vietnam, he bluntly stated, "A nation that continues year after year to spend more money on military defense than on programs of social uplift is approaching spiritual death." And if you want to take notes, at the end I'll offer a handout that has all the text, so you don't need to try and jot down all of this stuff.
Oh.
So when King talks about spiritual death because we keep spending more on militarism than on social uplift, is that something that might be behind the thinking of people when they answer public opinion polls that ask, is our nation on the wrong track? And we're getting more and more and more people answering, yes, our nation is on the wrong track. You know, they've been asking that for years. And those numbers, those poll numbers keep increasing. They don't ask specifically, is America on the wrong track because we are too damn militaristic? But they just ask, are we on the wrong track? And a lot of people say yes. And I'm guessing, my bias as an anti-militarist, is that there's something in what we're talking about here that is part of causing people to say, yeah, we're on the wrong track. Mm-hmm. So I think that's it.
I don't think that necessarily someone could say yes to that. A lot of people could say yes to that because we're not building more, bigger military or using it to the extent that we've paid for it.
Yeah, well,
we go kill more people. So our country is on the wrong track.
Yeah, we're too timid.
Yeah.
So, it's a badly worded question because it could mean either side of the spectrum.
Everybody gets to see the answer in their own.
Yeah, and that, of course, that's what I'm doing here too. But I would guess, because I talk with a lot of people, a lot of people are really uneasy about the way this country is going for the kinds of reasons we're talking about. So I would think this is part of it. There may be some people on the other side who think we have not yet established English as the official language. We have not yet established Christianity as the official religion. Right. We got to toughen up on that stuff.
Yeah.
So there may be some on that side. But anyway, Mary, you had something?
Well, just
and I want to keep all these brief.
The problem is that everyone feels like it's not working. I knew this woman, this black woman back in the day, and she used to say to her kids when they were in the other room making a noise, she'd say, whatever you're doing, stop it.
Yeah.
And I kind of like that. Stop it. It's not working.
Yeah.
Whatever. But then there's fear.
Yeah.
And then once you go to the fear.
Yeah.
On our side, it's the fear that we're not looking at what you're talking about. Other ways of looking at it that could work if given half a chance.
Uh-huh.
And then there's another segment that are saying we're not applying enough violence.
Yeah.
Let's apply more violence.
Right.
Those of us on our side would see obviously. Trillions of dollars are going down the toilet.
Yeah.
That either could be used to develop the infrastructure. But the other side is saying, obviously, to them, the welfare state is taking over, and too many people are relying upon the government. They got to be cut back and beef up the military more.
Right. Yeah. So anyway, there's stuff out there.
Yeah.
But we commonly see things from our perspective, even in this workshop where I've got my biases, and most of us have biases, and then you raise another viewpoint that you don't necessarily believe in, but you know it's out there.
If somebody in America agrees about the military, we wouldn't be spending more than 50% of our finances.
Yeah, there are powerful forces pushing in that direction. Yeah. Okay, what I want to do is have us play now with two case conflicts. We'll deal with one and then the other one. But with the roles reversed, one of the nice things about being an American is that we can always see things only from our own nationalistic perspective, and we don't have to give a damn about what it's like on the receiving end. We don't, being an American means never having to be empathetic with people elsewhere, never having to say you're sorry. So here, let's play with case one here. Imagine if Al-Qaeda had killed or disabled many thousands of Americans, young Americans, and what if Al-Qaeda had stolen trillions of dollars of U.S. taxpayer money? How would most Americans feel? I mean, look at how people felt after 9/11 attacks, but suppose they had done this with more people killed, more young Americans, disabled this huge number of Americans, and stolen trillions of dollars. Do you think, how would people feel in this country?
Pretty angry.
And why, when and we know the actual reality is that it's the United States foreign policy, our stupid wars that have disabled this whole generation of, or many people in the younger generation who have been suckered into the military because it was the only job in town, the only job available. And it's been horrendously expensive, terribly fraudulent in terms of the corruption and stuff. And so quick answers to three questions. One is, why aren't Americans angry with our government for this massive betrayal?
I think we're pretty disempowered.
Okay, we feel disempowered?
Well, in the past, when there was a scandal all over the news, action was taken.
Uh-huh.
You know, somebody lost their job, somebody went to court, they had national hearings. But during the Bush administration, all this stuff came out and no action
yeah.
was taken whatsoever.
Right. Just like with all the Wall Street stuff, the Obama administration didn't prosecute anybody, even though there was clear fraud from some of these big banks and so forth. Yeah.
You know, people are afraid to be called unpatriotic.
Yeah, right.
If they speak out.
Right. So anyway, there's much more reasons we could go to if we had more time.
Numbness and denial have to be there.
That's been, right. That's part of it. And part of it is the way the news media frame it, so you're not really allowed to ask or know about these things.
They won't even report it.
And they won't report it. Yeah, so they don't. Yeah. Okay.
Well, they don't report it.
Yeah. Second question then is, why don't the American people consider these facts, these hard realities? Part of it is the media don't report it. Are there other reasons why Americans don't even consider the facts, let alone get angry about them? But
I really think, you know, like every once in a while, I'll try to be quick. We make references to war as something that's been going on for 10,000 years.
Yeah.
Another workshop, somebody made that. But, you know, I think, not to be too erudite, but anthropologists state that war can't be universally defined by cultures.
Mm-hmm.
And I think America has a very specific war culture that's even a little different than Great Britain. And I'm not...
Oh.
I was in Great Britain during the debate for the first invasion of Iraq, uh-huh. Gulf War, I think
yeah,
it was
yeah,
called.
Yeah.
And I went to Parliament and listened to the debates. I was cut off from American news. I came home at Christmas and I nearly fell over. It was like two different cultures going to war.
Tell us the experience, your personal history from what you, because Stephen used to work inside the Pentagon, right?
Yeah.
With
wow.
Defense Intelligence Agency.
Right.
Tell us just briefly when that was, what your specialty was, and how you turned around. But keep it tight.
Well, I went from Georgetown. I worked for Scoop Jackson, Senator Jackson, at the Pentagon 65 to 69. Ended up on the Cambodian desk, studying Prince Sihanouk, the Khmer Rouge, the base areas along the Cambodian border. I quit more for just personal reasons. I was ready to try something else. And did. It was only later that I realized the enormity of what I've been a part of. So it was a, you know, for me it was a kind of a long, slow process.
But didn't you tell you one time years ago? You told me that when you had time off and went to Norway and you read foreign newspapers, you could see
yeah.
the reality in a way that he could not see working inside the Pentagon for the Defense Intelligence Agency.
That was going after I left in 69. I was a stockbroker for a while after that. But then I quit it all and went to Europe for a couple of years. It was at that point that I really started to open my eyes and see
yeah.
how they got a different slant, you know,
yeah.
the news in Norway. They tend to look at both sides of the equation, whereas we might just get one side.
Right. Thank you. Yeah, that's
just briefly, like when yeah. I was at the Parliament, at the Gulf War, the British were 99% behind the war. This is in 2003, uh-huh. This is 1990s. But the tone was so sober and somber. I came back, George Bush is on yeah. television with cheerleaders.
Yeah,
It was like absurd. It was like
yeah.
a parody.
Yeah, so
I think the revolt is underground. There are a lot of tax resistors. There's uh-huh. a lot of people who don't have television.
Mm-hmm.
Into the
yeah, mm-hmm. yeah. So the workshop here is designed to elicit things will pop up that we'll have to deal with later, but there's a sweep of things that we're moving through and we're almost on time, so this is good.
Okay.
So the other case that we could consider, and we won't take much time on it, but briefly, you know, Pakistan, you know, we've got this drone war against Pakistan, but officially Pakistan is our ally in the war on terror, right? So they're our ally, but we are attacking Pakistani people in their homes, in their neighborhoods, with our militarized drones, and what that's doing is turning ordinary Pakistani people not only against us, but also against their own government, which is failing to protect them from the U.S. attacks. Now, suppose we had somebody in this country, maybe somebody from Port Townsend, who was organizing against Pakistan, and Pakistan felt threatened by anti-Pakistan organizers in Port Townsend. And then So Pakistan shoots a drone at Fort Townsend. Well, they kind of missed. They didn't get your house or your house, but they got some of your neighbors. Well, now all of a sudden your whole neighborhood is mad, you know, or they missed that and they hit Seattle. Now we got Seattle mad, you know. I mean, if the roles were reversed and we had, and the government of Pakistan was militarily attacking people in United States neighborhoods, we'd be pissed. Suppose instead of Pakistan, suppose this was Russia. I mean, the Russian government has problems, and suppose there are people organizing in your neighborhood against the abuses of the Russian government, and Russia started firing drones into your neighborhood. You know, what? How would the politicians here respond? How would the news media respond? And if this seems wild, think this is what we're actually doing to a bunch of other countries, including Yemen and Somalia, and I mean, a bunch of these. Anyway, that's enough of that. So militarism becomes normalized. Somebody in the discussion early in the workshop talked about how this gets normalized. And it gets normalized at both the international level and the domestic level. And part of it is they do that by deceiving the American people and making that the default. And a few minutes ago, I quoted Martin Luther King's powerful speech about Vietnam and peace. In that same speech, King criticized the U.S. for being on the wrong side of history and in violently fighting poor people while militarily protecting corrupt elites, both in Vietnam and elsewhere. If you want, I really recommend reading his Beyond Vietnam speech. It was April 4, 1967. And it's just, he just nails it. Anyway, so politicians keep telling us that the U.S. is the greatest democracy in the world, which we know it's not. We have one of the worst voter turnout rates, one of the most corrupt systems. We actually rank low on international rankings about how different nations function as democracies. We rank really pretty low, so we're not really the greatest democracy on earth. They keep telling us that we're a shining beacon of freedom and liberty, and yet we're not really much of a shining beacon of freedom and liberty when we imprison more people and a bigger percentage of our people than any other country. We use militarism that practices terrorism on other countries, and we have police and prisons that terrorize our own people. We make the American people feel powerless, as somebody here said. And rather than in a real democracy, you'd have a robust democracy where people felt empowered to do things. And instead, people are kept ignorant, dumbed down, and suppressed in various ways. And so it just goes on and on and on. Some of us who pay attention to what happens to whistleblowers realize that the Obama administration has been the most hostile toward journalism of any administration in U.S. history, including Nixon, who was notoriously against journalism. The Obama administration has prosecuted more whistleblowers than all of the presidents in U.S. history combined. So this is not a partisan matter. This is these problems that we're talking about are bipartisan. So who could say briefly what's the difference between misinformation and disinformation? Toss it out quickly, somebody. Misinformation versus...
Disinformation is done intentionally, right? A power that has the ability to do it.
Right, and it's actually replacing truth with...
Right, where misinformation is just a kind of like a misunderstanding.
You got your facts wrong.
You got your facts wrong.
And disinformation is you're trying to propagandize me deliberately with false facts so that I will think Obama's a Muslim, or Obama,
right.
But it doesn't come just from the right wing. It comes from the power. Yeah. Anyway, so when politicians and mainstream media and the dominant nationalistic culture replace knowledge with lies, this leads Americans to believe in American exceptionalism, the notion that there's something about this country that just entitles us to do the kinds of things other countries that we've been talking about. We are so special, we are not even bound by international law. And for the climate deniers, we're not even bound by the laws of science. There are laws about how geology and chemistry and atmospheric sciences and all this stuff works. We're not even bound by the laws of science because we're Americans.
Well, actually, I want to correct you.
Okay,
we're
please.
We're not bound by the laws of nature.
That's it.
Not laws of nature. Yeah.
The laws
yeah.
of nature.
Yeah. That's more profound. Yeah. Yeah. So that's it. So it's not only are we above international law, but above the laws of nature. That's better yet. Yeah. Thank you. This means that we're entitled to attack any country we wanted to, and nobody should question it. And we're entitled to prevent real solutions to the climate crisis and so forth. In ancient Greece, the Greek tragedies were based on a kind of arrogance for which the Greek word was hubris, H-U-B-R-I-S. And this is the kind of arrogance that led the leading figure in a Greek tragedy to his own downfall, his overreach, his arrogance. He was usurping the role of the gods and did such overreach that it caused him to be defeated ultimately in the Greek tragedy. And over all these Greek tragedies, that's what was going on. And of course, we can see where U.S. hubris leads us, not only on the climate crisis, not only on the foreign policy issues, but on so many other things. So I just want to put that out there as a model to think about. So somebody early on in this conversation mentioned fear. So one way to militarize our culture is to inject massive amounts of fear into it. And so we're told to be afraid of, who are we told to be afraid of? Everything, everybody, Muslims, foreigners, Mexican immigrants, black people.
Oh yeah, and our racism at home.
Yeah.
Consciously, deliberately, yeah. or subconsciously, is woven into
it's,
our
yeah,
strategies.
All kinds of stuff about black people. All kinds of stuff about immigrants from coming up from Mexico.
Well, the tribal people of Pakistan that we bombed are
yeah.
really different than, you know, we have a whole disrespect for their
yeah.
their culture.
Yeah.
They have a welcoming culture, and they invite people to their village, and we bomb the village, and we kill innocent people.
Yeah, yeah. So this fear, when you have fear as the undergirding for our modern society, it leads to all kinds of bad repercussions. And General MacArthur, of all people, figured this out. And he said on May 15, 1951, General Douglas MacArthur, he said, quote, "It is part of the general pattern of misguided policy that our country is now geared to an arms economy which was bred in an artificially induced psychosis of war hysteria and nurtured upon an incessant propaganda of fear," unquote. I never would have expected that from Douglas MacArthur. And I didn't check the original source, but I saw that in some source. I don't remember what the source was. I didn't footnote it in my notes.
I think FDR said it much more succinctly. We have nothing to fear but fear itself.
Right. And some people latched onto that and kind of perverted this into a clever scheme to hook us onto perpetual fear, right?
Let's promote fear.
Wow, that's a moneymaker for somebody, and it's a power grab for somebody. Somebody also said that war is terrorism with a bigger budget, and I think that's great. It's the same dynamic, though, you know, shock and awe and all that stuff. Okay, so in our lives, we're a little bit behind time, but not severely so, about 7 minutes late. In our daily lives, we know better than this. I mentioned when we did the workshop introductions about, you know, what are the workshops about. I said that I worked for a state agency, and the agency I dealt with, our whole purpose, it was the State Department of Personnel. And so I interacted, and our agency interacted with every state agency there was in Washington State. And we often had things we disagreed with. But in the 22 years I worked there, nobody ever said, "Let's get a bunch of guns and go over to the Department of Transportation and start shooting people until they see things our way," or let's bomb the headquarters of the Department of Social and Health Services. Nobody said that. In our daily lives, we have better sense than what we're talking about here, which is at the institutional political level. But when we've normalized war in such a way, the things that we have a good sense for in our daily lives, we don't do that here, but we do it internationally. If your neighbor's dog is barking, you don't shoot the dog, you know. If your car doesn't run properly, you don't shoot your car. You don't beat on it with a big hammer. You figure out, why does my car run, and fix it. Well, I don't know your car. But the idea is, if your car doesn't work, you figure out why, what's not working. You know, is this an electrical problem? Is it not getting fuel? It's what, you know, what's going on? And but you don't just shoot the car and hope that somehow that'll fix it. But at the foreign policy level, that's what we do. We don't find out what's the conflict about. What, you know, how do people perceive things? What's going on? Anyway, so what we need to do is renounce violence at the international level, just like you do at the motor vehicle level, or the barking dog next door level, or your family. Although I haven't met your family members, so I don't know about. But probably you don't shoot them either if you have. So militarism backfires, and military solutions, in quotation marks, are really the problem. And so this is the core of the workshop's title, that military solutions, in quotation marks, are really what the problem is. And the truth is that besides militarism not working, it actually backfires. It makes things worse. And so I want to engage a conversation here, again, with pretty quick answers about that. And I want to just lay out a little bit more preface before we do a lot of Q&A here. A lot of people don't see the connection between means and ends, and they think that the end justifies the means. And within the FOR, our ethics, and Gandhi's ethics and King's ethics and the FOR's ethics, all affirm that the ends that we reach depend on the means we use to get there. So if you want peace, you have to use peaceful means, and that's how we get there. We have lots of examples of how people that our military is fighting are using weapons that we had provided to somebody when those people were either supposed to be our allies or they got them from our allies. And who can toss out some quick answers of when we're U.S. military fighting people who are using weapons provided by the U.S.?
Iraq, Afghanistan.
Yeah.
Everywhere yeah. in Africa.
Yeah, yeah, with Africa and Libya. It happened in Vietnam.
Oh, in Latin America and different places.
Yeah.
Israel,
yeah, yeah. And ISIS came partly out of the people that we were arming, the moderates we were arming in Syria. I mean, so it's this, and sometimes these things don't even take a long turnaround. Sometimes these are very quick. The Mujahideen that became Al-Qaeda, Reagan was funding them through the CIA. It just goes on and on and on.
And I'm sure there's many we don't know about.
Yeah, yeah.
Sold through other agents.
Right, a lot of
people
things.
People buy arms sometimes. They think they're buying them from one person and someone else is selling.
Yeah,
them. Agents.
And because we don't track those well, because some arms manufacturers are making money and they don't want that stuff to be tracked. Right. And there's huge amounts of that kind of stuff. So military violence always, or at least nearly always, backfires, but I would say always. And it creates more enemies who want to do harm to our country and our people, and it creates new enemies for us to attack. And so it just keeps the cycle going. We treat Iran like an enemy, but we had messed up Iraq in ways that tilted them toward the Shia, which was the dominant population, the dominant variation of Islam in Iraq and also in Iran. So as we screwed up Iraq internally, it opened the way for Iran to have dominance. So here, the United States has for decades thought that Iran is our enemy, and we've screwed up Iraq in such a way that Iran is really very powerful in Iraq. And we're funding sometimes Shia to shoot Sunni, and sometimes we're funding Sunni to shoot Shia. It's just, and everybody hates us. I mean, for that kind of stuff. Somebody from the University of North Carolina did some research, found that between 1997 and 2006, U.S. military assistance correlated with a 67% increase in the duration of terrorist campaigns in the country receiving the U.S. military aid. So U.S. military aid has been shown statistically to enlarge and extend the duration of conflicts. Jeremy Scahill, U.S. journalist, said, U.S. policy has been its own worst enemy. We've created the very threats we claim to be fighting. Now, the CIA invented the term blowback, right? and we know the term blowback, the sense that you do something and it pisses them off and they want to come back at us. The CIA invented the term because they knew this was happening. And yet, the CIA keeps doing things that promote more of that. The Pentagon keeps doing more of that. Congress and the president, no matter which party is running Congress or no matter which party has a president, they keep doing things to promote more blowback. So I'm interested in why that happens. So toss out insights you may have about that.
It's a great business.
Yeah?
I don't hear the blowback discussion being very widespread, you know? I mean, Chalmers Johnson did a nice book about that really helped us sort of understand it. But I don't hear the news media talking about that too much. No one says, well, look, at, you know, we actually armed Al-Qaeda and Osama bin Laden used to work for the CIA.
Right.
Nobody said those things when we went to war in Afghanistan. So I feel like there's a kind of a denial of that.
Right. And we'll talk about denialism in a little bit too. So thanks for that heads up.
So part of it, I think, is we don't understand the stuff.
Yeah.
I mean, there's a difference between listening to regular media and listening to Amy Goodman on Democracy Now. Mm-hmm. When you're listening to Democracy Now, you get a feeling that there's depth to her analysis, to her their understanding. She brings people in. Regular media, you get 30 seconds, 45 seconds, a minute or two of something, and there's no history, there's no depth, there's no understanding.
Yeah. Do you remember the story of Ray Bonner? Since you're mentioning like the news media bias, why it never gets to, when under Carter, we were working with the government of El Salvador to suppress the people who were rising up in El Salvador, and this continued into the Reagan era, and you know, I mean, we were funding, you know, they had the death squads that the United States was supporting. It was just this horrible, horrible, violent repression, and the people were trying to rise up and do that. Ray Bonner was a reporter from New York Times, and he was down there, and he was trying to find out what's really going on. So he went out into the countryside, talked with people, found out what was really going on. It turned out, you know, the United States was the problem. And so he was giving news reports, not biased stuff, but he was just reporting on the reality of who is it that's being shot, who, well, you know, all these dead people that end up in the ditch by the roadside, clearly death squad activity, what's happening? And he was reporting on the facts. And the most of these foreign journalists, the journalists in foreign countries, journalists from the U.S. in foreign countries, hang out a lot at the U.S. Embassy because they'll have a question, they'll get a news release, the ambassador says, well, here's today's news, boys, you know, and most of them just go back and diligently type it up as saying, here's the news, you know, ambassador said blah, blah, blah. And so he would ask questions, and the ambassador did not like it, and so the ambassador stopped returning his phone calls, refused to answer his questions at the press conferences or whatever. New York Times said, their response was, you know, it doesn't make any sense for us to have a journalist in El Salvador if the U.S. ambassador in El Salvador refuses to talk to our journalist. So they pulled him out of there. And they gave him some innocuous assignment like doing real estate reporting or something in New York City because he was no good to the New York Times in El Salvador. And then we had in Seattle, Mike Layton. Remember Mike Layton? He used to write for the PI. He wrote really, really good stuff. And he was in, same thing happened to him with Nicaragua. And Seattle PI would not run his stuff after a while because it did not jibe with everything else that was in the Seattle Times news about Nicaragua because he was actually reporting the truth.
I considered 9/11 blowback.
Oh yeah, it very, very clearly is. Yeah, talk with Bert Sachs or there's some other folks around here. This is very much part of it. Anyway, but the news goes in those ways and so there are reasons why we don't hear about things. And Mary Lou and Carrie mentioned some reasons. The other thing that occurs to me is. Even though blowback makes things worse for our country, when we provoke more enemies, when we have more enemies, when we have more simultaneous wars, what happens to the Pentagon budget and the CIA budget?
Goes down.
goes up. So, if you're a governmental agency and you cause problems that make things worse, and the result is that when you screw up and make things worse, you get a bigger budget, where's the incentive? The incentive is to provoke more enemies, right? What happens when you get a bigger budget and when decisions are being made and in government and all of a sudden we got more enemies for the CIA and the Pentagon to deal with, they get more power, right? Along with Irene's bigger budget. So here, when you screw up, instead of being punished, like Bush's No Child Left Behind, where if a school has low test scores, we yank your funding. Mm-hmm. Here, if you screw up, and you're the Pentagon or the CIA, and you screw up really, really bad and make things worse, we give you more money, and we give you more political power, more control over U.S. foreign policy. It's the absolute disincentive if you want peace. But this is built into the system of how things work, right? So we might ask, and you might answer in your own heart, if they're deliberately promoting the war on terror in this way for self-serving purposes. I happen to believe they are. Okay, I'm hearing yeses around the room, so this is not a radical conspiracy theory. But it really works. And of course, the military-industrial complex that some folks have mentioned. Okay. The biggest threat to U.S. security then is not some poor Muslim in Pakistan or someplace who's mad at us. The biggest threat to our security in our nation is our own military establishment, right? And news media are part of this as well. So if we want a peaceful and just domestic society, likewise, besides foreign policy, we have to rely on peaceful and just means, because the same kinds of dynamics are happening. If the police provoke violence in black neighborhoods or in poor neighborhoods or in whatever, and the people of that city get afraid, unless there's somebody there to have a counter narrative as to what's going on, why the violence is happening, the reaction of a lot of people is say, holy crap, there's all this window breaking in our town, all these people rioting in the streets, all these people doing whatever, we better have more police and they better clamp down more. And so, I mean, that same kind of dynamic could happen domestically as well as internationally, unless we have people, have a seat, Peg, unless we have people who are offering the narrative about why this is happening. And this is true domestically, I would suggest. So we want to turn the corner toward a nonviolent foreign policy, right? Which would be a nonviolent domestic policy. Most people in this country, naively, as we said earlier, assume that our foreign policy focuses on advancing democracy in other countries and promoting freedom. I mean, this is what we do, right? We're the great beacon of liberty and freedom. And so we think that we help these other nations with generous foreign aid. They don't realize that a huge amount of foreign aid is actually subsidies for foreign countries to buy weapons, and then the U.S. taxpayers subsidize part of the purchase price of their weapons that they buy from the U.S. manufacturers. So really, it's corporate welfare for Boeing and Lockheed and Northrop Grumman and General Dynamics and on and on and on. The aid that we do is not really designed to help those countries. It's mostly designed to manipulate them and then make them dependent on U.S. Because once you've got, if you've got a weapon made by General Dynamics and you need a spare part, you go back to General Dynamics. You know, you don't buy your spare parts from your local hardware store in Guatemala. You know, you get them from the manufacturer. So it's a way to hook people into that supply chain. Think about your own personal values. Think about the FOR's values. Imagine what would be different if the U.S. were to base our foreign policy upon the values that you hold as to what really animates your thinking, your heart, or the FOR's values, if we were to base foreign policy on that. How would that foreign policy be different from what we have now? Just toss out some quick answers.
Non-militaristic.
Need to do a lot of conflict resolution work, training people how to do that kind of conflict.
Wow, okay, great, okay.
Underwriting social programs.
Social programs like?
Networking, food, education.
Yeah.
Healthcare.
Yeah, healthcare.
Really, like creating a society that's less based on competition and some of our current success values.
Mm-hmm.
Because in a way, I think our new militarism, since the Cold War ended, is based a little bit on the neoliberal global concept. And I think Americans are, I think even more than promoting democracy, Americans feel we're in a very competitive world now.
Oh.
You know, now there wasn't a China before, there wasn't an India, there wasn't, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And I think in a way, our new militarism is based a little bit on a fear of scarcity, even among in abundance.
Yeah, so we got to make sure that we have our access to those,
together to
and our access to the resources that we need, so that China doesn't get them or
stabilizing
whatever. Yeah.
You know.
Okay. Great. Thank you, Lloyd.
I think there would be a huge effort in educating ourselves about the issues of other countries. This is Syria. This is its history. This is its culture. This is its people.
Uh-huh.
This is the roots of the conflict. These are the options.
Yeah.
I think there'd be a big focus on trauma all over the place, on healing trauma. Being the, and that means the trauma to the earth, global warming, and the trauma to the beings on the earth, us.
Yeah.
Both as us as oppressors and us as oppressed, because we're all in both roles. You know.
Yeah.
And it's kind of like, you know, when you take ice cream and it's chocolate over here and it's white here, and you soften it up and you start mixing it.
Yeah.
And pretty soon, it's, you know, it's sort of a swirl of the oppressed and oppressing, and that trauma, the idea of healing trauma. But it's not just that. I mean, I think it's slowing ourselves down so that we can think straight, because all this fear really hurts the ability to think well and creatively.
Yeah.
When you're in fear, your sense of other options basically shrivels.
Yeah, yeah.
And your ability to listen to other
people. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So healing the trauma would break the cycle of violence,
right?
Because so much of the conflict within a country or between countries has to do with trauma they've experienced. I mean, it's 100 years after the Turkish government slaughtered
Armenians,
and that conflict is still very much alive among Armenians and among the Turkish government. It's 100 years later, they've not resolved it. And that conflict, but so healing the trauma would be a huge...
In our country, recognizing it. Because I was talking with Wilson about this a lot, and Brian Wilson, and you know, we're all traumatized.
Yeah,
Say so, and some don't.
Yeah.
And some have massive, you know, PTSD, you know, and some of us have lower level. But its effects are the same.
So we need to address this. Now, this would be a whole different, more humane, more holistic approach towards solving global problems, rather than saying we should send a drone into that neighborhood because somebody we don't like might be there right now.
Yeah, I just think the other piece is that we can't continue to be something like 6% of the world's population consuming 40% of the world's resources. Because a lot of that military, I mean, you can solve conflicts with other people, but I don't know that you can take their resources.
So
we have to figure out how to live more simply.
So I earlier, thank you. So earlier in this conversation, I mentioned hubris, that extreme arrogance that in Greek tragedy is what leads to the downfall of the main character. And the United States keeps acting on this hubris of American exceptionalism. And if we want to have a nonviolent foreign policy, or a nonviolent domestic policy, for that matter, how could we help our nation repent and heal from the hubris that has been plaguing other countries and our own culture, our own people? What would you recommend as some first steps toward repentance and healing from hubris so we can move into a better future? Just toss out quick ideas, Peg.
I've been expressing this here, and I've been expressing this over several years, actually. There's a verse, how beautiful, sincere lament,
the vision born, the born of tears, the courage called for to repent, the bloodshed through the years. America, America, oh grant that we may be a nation blessed with none oppressed, true land of liberty. And what I am proposing, I did a fast during a Lenten fast, and I see my Christian heritage as, and us in this country, needing to look at our own history and repent. And I am proposing that we join together in some way, publicly, in a 40-day Lenten fast, and that would bring together some of the issues that we're, of the things we're doing, you know, Israel, Palestine, immigration policies, black oppression, and so on, poverty and homelessness, could all rise up. And there could be, a part of it could be a vision. See, it wouldn't just be repentance.
Yeah.
But there would be a vision of world healing that would go side by side.
That's great. I like that. Email me with that kind of a thing. And I like that approach. I'd like to help push ahead. Lloyd, and I want to, we'll catch Lloyd. But I want to make sure that people who have not spoken up much get a fair chance to speak up to the extent that they want, even though answers are basically short. But I want to make sure we hear from people besides those who are most ready to jump into a conversation.
So it would be miraculous if we caught up with the history of indigenous people in this country, what happened, I mean, for everybody to hear, to hear it from Native Americans.
Uh-huh. Yes.
I think that would tell us a lot about ourselves and what we are.
Yeah, that's a good step. Other steps to heal us from the hubris?
I think if we can get that, what I call compensatory consumption, also known as shopping therapy and so forth, to be uncool. You know, that making simplicity cool and making that kind of, you know, having lots of stuff or having to have the latest stuff. I've got the latest phone, I've got the most apps, blah, 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 to make that uncool. Because America, it does have an ability to make things cool.
Yeah.
And every now and again, it comes from our side.
Yeah, yeah. Who are you apart from the brand of tennis shoes that you wear? You know, who are you really other than your car that you drive?
When you're sad and fearful, and numb and all the rest of it.
Yeah.
Shopping therapy is the thing that people do in this country.
Yeah. Yeah.
Let's go.
So So supporting some other way, better ways of meeting those needs, and also better ways of helping people identify who they are other than what they wear, what they drive, and so forth.
Yeah.
That's good.
Going after the materialism, because that's what King said, that materialism was the peak. He called it gross materialism or something, but it feeds violence.
Right, yeah. Yeah, yeah. Michael, you have something quick?
I think, I'm not sure what the title of this workshop is, because I picked up on
it. Yeah, we'll tell you later.
It seems to me that a lot of what we need to be doing, and I think the suggestions that are coming around the room, are ones that are aimed at convincing ourselves that things need to change. And I think that's one of our biggest problems, is doing things that move people off of their comfort zone and getting them to think about other ways of behaving in the world and in their own lives that will make a difference ultimately.
Okay.
I also think that probably the only way that we're going to get any real systemic change is to bring the system down. And we have to be ready for that.
Yeah.
And prepared for it.
Yeah. So the workshop is about debunking the notion that military, quote, solutions are a solution. Military solutions actually are the problem, and that's what the workshop is. And then we're looking at manifestations of how that's occurred and what do we do instead. So that's the point that we're at. I want to move us ahead briefly through the next step and then on to some more discussion or questions. So we've got in our society, we've talked about some myths and misconceptions that are bogging us down, preventing us from healing and moving on. There are a couple others I want to just mention and then move on. We allow the systems of militarism and patriotism and nationalism to dump things out there, myths and misconceptions that they've been telling us that allow us to support, for example, the Vietnam War. They said, well, Asians don't value human life. I remember hearing this from people. Lots of people used to say, well, Asians don't value life, so it's okay for us to kill a bunch of people in Vietnam. We're doing this for their own well-being. It's for their own good that we're in there making a war against these people. We're winning the war. They kept telling us all the way through the Vietnam War that we were winning it all the way up to the very end when we lost. And same thing as the War on Terror. Oh, yeah, we're making progress. Oh, yeah. And we're losing. So there's all these myths and misconceptions, and we need to let go of that kind of stuff. They tell us since September 11 some myths and misconceptions, call out some short answers as to what the lies, the myths and misconceptions that have been fed to us about whatever happened on September 11 and beyond.
Iraq had missiles.
Okay, yeah, that's one.
Iraq caused 9/11.
That was one, yeah.
They want us to liberate it.
Yeah.
Muslims are the problem.
Yeah. Those people have always been fighting. They just can't get along with each other. So.
We're going in to help the women.
Yes. Okay, so we got the idea. So we got the idea here that these things are continually being fed to us. I want to play with something about the denial aspect. Somebody mentioned something about denying. The movement to protect the Earth's climate has to deal with the climate deniers. Likewise, if we want to have a peaceful foreign policy, we have to deal with the people who deny that peace is possible. And people who deny the kinds of truths that we've been saying during this workshop. So the climate deniers, I would assert, cause two big problems. One is climate deniers are rich and powerful, and so they shape public policy. Second thing is climate deniers deceive and confuse the general public in order to prevent real solutions. Likewise, the people who deny that peace is possible are doing exactly the same thing. The peace deniers are rich and powerful, and so they shape public policy. The peace deniers, likewise, deceive and confuse the general public in order to prevent real solutions. So somehow, folks like us need to become more savvy in how to deal with the deniers, whether it's confronting them directly or communicating with the general public to undermine the BS that we get from them. But somehow we need to do that. So I'm curious if you can call out some short answers about what strategies and methods might we use to reduce the power and influence of the peace deniers, the people who say that we can never get to peace, we got to do the military, blah, blah, blah. What are some strategies and methods we might use to reduce their power to shape public policy?
I keep thinking rap songs. That's how you're going to reach a lot of people.
What would
rap songs?
Oh.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Well, actually, music on either YouTube or whatever, all kind of cultural. Films can do it beautifully, regular people.
Something the regular people will be drawn to or watch, even watch. Because it's reaching the multitude. Yeah.
Humor, satire, ridicule are great ways to pull the rug out from under arrogant abusers. Carrie?
John Stewart.
Yeah. Anyway, we could think, if we had more time, we could play with some more and generate them. I want to do the second part of why these people are problematic, and that's how can we protect the public from being deceived and confused by the peace deniers? How can we, are there ways that we can protect the public beyond anything that we've said already?
Jam TV.
I could imagine a situation where the general public believed that we're getting a lot of propaganda. And so that they're not so susceptible to it.
Okay, that would be a quick thing to get a show of hands. How many people think the public is sort of figuring out the BS that's out there? Is that kind of along the way of what you're saying? I'm just going to show of hands. How many people think public is kind of figuring out that we're being lied to? Yeah. A fair amount? Several hands. More than before. Yeah. Okay. Great. Yeah.
See. But sometimes they figure out they've been lied to, and then they jump from the frying pan into the fire.
Yeah.
That's the ones who turn on Fox News.
Yeah.
They are convinced that they're being lied to.
Mainstream media.
Mainstream media.
Yeah. Okay.
And they probably are.
But
I was just very discouraged when ISIS started, mm-hmm. and all the ISIS attacks, and I was at the Democratic headquarters locally against the TPP, but that's a different story.
Yeah.
But I was there and talking to people, and they said, well, how can we not go in? Mm-hmm. Yeah. We have to fight ISIS.
Yeah, those people haven't come
so
by workshop. Yeah, those people should have come to my workshop. And the ISIS thing, I think, I don't know if it's coming up yet or if it was something I jumped past. I think it's still yet coming up. But why did ISIS make a big deal about publicizing that they were beheading people? They did. I mean, when they did that beheading, they vigorously publicized, hey, we're beheading some people. Why did... Huh? PR? In what way? We took the bait.
Yeah.
They knew.
Oh, yeah.
They knew what my workshop says, which is U.S. militarism or anybody's militarism backfires. And so they knew that if they could sucker the United States into fighting them, that the U.S. would lose. And that's, of course, what's happening. So they deliberately did that. So when somebody says, oh, ISIS beheaded these people, we have to go in after them, they are falling for exactly what ISIS wanted us to do.
But these were progressive Democrats.
They're still trapped in U.S. militarism.
How did ISIS know, what was their reasoning to know that they, by suckering in the U.S.,
the last real war the United States won was World War II. 1945.
We didn't win it, the Soviets did.
And the Soviets actually did the heavy lifting, but we were one of the victorious nations. But anyway, but since then we have not won. We've been at war almost continuously for 70 years. We have not won any of them. Some of them we've lost big time, like Vietnam. Korea was a tie. There's a truce, but there never was a peace settlement. So
I think we might have won Grenada.
Yeah, we kicked butt there, yeah. But anyway, the point is that U.S. militarism, for 70 years, U.S. militarism has not let us win a single war because it's inherently self-defeating. And ISIS knows that, and that we sucker ourselves into these things, and we're losing big time over there, yeah.
So to answer your question, one of the goals of Osama bin Laden was to bring the United States into the Middle East so we would lose a war, because that's what he saw with Afghanistan and Russia.
Yeah. That's right.
When Russia went into Afghanistan and they lost the war, but also their economy collapsed.
And the nation collapsed.
And if you look at what happened to us, financially collapsed after the war.
And he knew that. So Osama bin Laden, the United States, the CIA had funded the Mujahideen in Afghanistan, and deliberately, there's a quotation, I mean, there's information from the top, Brzezinski and other folks, that was the intention was to arm radical Muslims that we thought could be on our side because we've armed them to bog down the Russian occupation of Afghanistan and hurt the Soviet Union. And so we did that, but the people we armed became problematic, and then we got ourselves bogged down in this. Osama bin Laden used the same tactic against us, as you, just as Kerry said so perfectly. And we keep causing ourselves to fight additional wars that we can't win, and every one of them crashes against us and hurts us and disables more of our people. We got thousands of people on medical disabilities who've been traumatized by the war, lost lives, lost legs, lost their minds. These people will be on disabilities from the time that they're in their 20s for the rest of their lives, and we're going to be paying expensive VA bills for these people, pensions, disability benefits, all kinds of stuff. These people are not in the productive workforce. They could not hold families. This is a great exaggeration, a stereotype, but in many, many, many cases, their families broke apart. They ended up homeless. This is the war that we thought we were doing against Muslim terrorists, we did against our own people, and we are destroying the United States economy because we're fighting foreign wars and destroying the American people and destroying the American culture and everything else. Anyway, that's that. Point then is that this stuff is inherently self-defeating. What we need to have, and we're running really tight on time, is the handout. I'll offer a handout to anybody that wants it. The last page of the handout, I'll just show you what it looks like, and I'll give you a copy if you want. But we have the usual way that we've worked for national security, thinking of national security, which is like, how can the United States be dominant over other nations and therefore secure? It doesn't work. It's self-defeating economically, financially, humanly, in every way. If we had some kind of true security, it would be a whole different model. So, for example, instead of having a way that we get secure by dominating everybody else, we would actually be truly secure if we cooperated fairly and got along with others. So instead of defeating enemies militarily, interact so that we don't have enemies. Get along.
How would you ever intimidate him?
Well, we don't need to intimidate. We're just going to collaborate. So instead of having an axis of evil that Bush identified as Iraq, Iran, and North Korea, who actually had nothing in common with each other, they were totally opposite. Martin Luther King never called any people evil, but he identified three evil systems: racism, militarism, and poverty, or the materialism. Yeah, he used different terms. So the methods, the goals, the methods, and so forth are all different. So instead of ending up with global chaos, we end up with global cooperation and a decent human family. So let me send these around. This has the text, basically the text of what I've been saying, has the questions that I've been asking. For a couple of questions, it suggests a couple of answers, but we did the answers from here orally. But anyway, if you want, you can self-administer this, whether you were here for the entire 90 minutes or only part of it, or you could sit down with some friends and talk it through and engage a conversation. I know one couple that's not available for this workshop, but I gave them a copy in advance. They're going to read this as they drive home. One spouse will drive, the other spouse will read, and they will both discuss.
I have a question for you.
Yes.
When there was a drag, I could persuade people to be conscientious. Uh
huh.
Speak a little louder, please.
Now that there is no draft, how do you stop young people signing up?
Well, okay, she asked about she was trying to urge people to become conscientious objectors while the draft was in effect, and now how do you discourage people from signing up? We have a poverty draft, as you know, where we've ruined the economy, we've shipped the jobs away, and so people don't have other jobs, but the military is always hiring, and so they can offer stuff. We have defunded education, but the military says, well, come and work for us and we'll put you through school. And in fact, they don't, because they have They screw people. Yeah, they screw people out of their educational benefits horribly. So part of it is being an informed consumer, and don't let the military recruiter, who's a salesperson, fool you without finding things out. So don't buy a car unless you've researched, you know, to find out if it's a lemon.
And then
we need to gear up. There are counter recruitment efforts, and it would be good to change our cultural values so that people think about conscientious objectors. One example that I'd give, we'll hit the questions in just a second, but I want to do one thing about on the military contract. There's a question that says, are you a conscientious objector? And people don't know what that is because it's never talked about in our society. And the recruiter just tells the kid, just mark no. My proposal that I've been urging for decades is nobody should be allowed to join the military until you have wrestled with your conscience to the extent that the draft law or the military law, if you're already in the military, requires you to wrestle with your conscience and document, with the way it is now, you have to document why you're a conscientious objector, what your beliefs are that prohibit you from killing in war and so forth. I say that they should have it the other way around, so that you cannot join the military unless you've wrestled with your conscience to that extent and written out your very thorough essay about why your conscience and your religious faith allow you to kill people in other countries. Mm-hmm. Only after you have convinced them, including the psychiatric interview, are you allowed to join the military.
So in other words, you want to get rid of the military.
But it's just flipping the burden of proof. That's my proposal. Yeah, you got to be an informed consumer, and then there's more to it than that. We got to rebuild the civilian economy.
Let me just add something quickly. That you brought up of the change in those years. I don't have the answer to this, but I don't think we've begun to see the impact of the post-draft years in this 20 years of endless war, because our young people are being sent in different directions. Serving, not serving, veterans coming home, turning against war. I don't think we've seen the impact on our society yet.
Okay, I want to see if we can get. We're actually at the closing time. I want to hit briefly the any closing thoughts, Gary.
Yeah, one of the things that we can do is question the legitimacy of military spending, and FOR had a Bring Our Billions Home campaign, which we may do in the future. But they're planning to replace all the nuclear weapons in this country.
Yeah.
And this is trillions and trillions of dollars. Money that's coming out of your pocket, and out of your schools, your bridges, your health care, and everything.
Yeah.
And nobody's asking you whether you want to spend it. Nobody knows about it.
Nobody knows.
Yeah. Happening. Well, thanks to the news media. And the politicians. Yeah, Mary?
Yeah, real short. On this thing about the draft, if kids are confused, I know this is way out of the frame of this, but the book, What Color Is Your Parachute, makes you an expert about yourself.
Yeah.
It makes you think about what you're good at and what you care about, what you like to do, and so forth. And if I only have a few seconds to deal with the young person, I throw that book at him and even let him get mad at me for giving him advice, but I'm saying, I can't give you advice. You have to figure it out for yourself. But here's a framework that you can use to help you start figuring that out, because that's what that book's about. And that way you don't think about, what corporation can I join, or should I be in the military? That binary thinking, it breaks that down.
Yeah, good.
A good start.
I think that that's more for middle class.
No, I totally disagree. Okay. I think that...
You think that the poor person has lousy education can read the book.
Yeah.
I think that at least it gives them an option. There's a simpler version of it that says, if you don't know where you're going, you're likely to wind up somewhere else. And that's a simplified version. It's the concept that you are the expert about you, not a corporation, not even the school counselor.
Right.
You are.
Yeah. I noticed that before I printed this out, I did a little bit of minor tweaking, and I think what happened is on the bottom of page 9, the page break that should have been there moved on to page 10, caused a page break, so that page 10 is blank, page 11 and 12 should have been 10 and 11, page 12 is where the table that I described should have been. So you don't have the table in front of you, but it looks like what I showed you, and I will, let's see. If you want, I'll email you the thing with the correct thing.
If you'll give me your files, I'll put them up on the OF, the
Yeah, we'll do that. I'm going to post this on Olympia's website as well. Okay. But give me an email address and write legibly, and I'll email you the correct the thing with the table. But this has, I'll give you the whole thing. But this has all the text that I've said, all the questions that we've discussed. So you can replicate at home, or meet with your friend and a bottle of cheap wine and have a great time.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you all.